Dr. Jonathan Murphy is our Associate Professor of Pastoral Ministries. He comes to the seminary from a variety of places. He was born in Northern Ireland. He was raised in Spain. He was educated in Northern Ireland, Scotland, and Texas. Such cross-cultural exposure has nurtured a diverse range of interests, from cheering for Ulster in rugby and Spain in soccer to enjoying all the things related to history. I guess that's Texas, but I'm not sure. He earned both his THM and his PhD from here at DTS. He pastored in Northern Ireland before joining the faculty in 2015. He loves his wife, Sarah Jane, who was on staff with us in our advancement department while he was a student. He calls his four little hobbits, Sienna, Joshua, Jake, and James. Loves the local church, rugby, more rugby. Hint, hint, if you want to do well in his classes. But you need to know he absolutely hates pickles and cannot understand American fascination with them. Maybe jalapenos would be better. It's a privilege to have him back on our campus and his extended ministry beyond our campus. Would you please join me in welcoming Dr. Jonathan Murphy to our platform this morning?
Well, good morning, and yes, thank you for those kind words, Dr. Bailey. Maybe we could record them later so that I can add them to my ringtone and get a little boost from time to time. Wow. And yeah, my apologies to all of you who are pickle lovers. I mean, you are a mystery to me, but it's dangerous to preach in chapel when you teach preaching at this school. And I don't fear speaking here. I fear going into my class tomorrow morning, knowing that my students are going to have their own sermon evaluation forms completed and very eager to give me a dose of my own bitter medicine. So we'll see how that goes tomorrow. It is a privilege to speak this morning, to share with you in this our formal theological home. This is where I was formed in many ways by the Lord, and so it's a pleasure to be here and speak to you. I have four little hobbits at home, and they're giving me quite a headache these days with some of their theological formation. We've had a couple of bumps along the way in the recent months, a couple of hiccups. James is my one-year-old, and he's developing a little bit of a rebellious streak against the head of household. I've been instructing him in language studies for a year now, and just the other week he came off with his first word, and it was a very clear mama. Now that's quite upsetting after all the work I've put into his language studies, but he's kind of like first year DTS students, just a little bit shocked about life around here. Then there's Jake, who's my 5-year-old, and he's quite a character. He's kind of like second year students at DTS. He's full of passion, but still struggling to figure out some of the theological words and concepts that are thrown around. And so he's taken to singing, and he just bursts into these spontaneous worship songs in the car these days. And you know, Patrick, forgive my poor vocals, but I'm gonna sort of throw myself out there and offer up to you one of his latest songs. And it goes like this. He says, God is real. God is real. But dreams are not real. But dreams are not real. God is real. And then he builds to this climax where he goes, God is real. And so is Santa. Is going on here, this guy? So we've got a rebellious one-year-old and a sort of passionate but kind of misguided 5-year-old. Then I have a 9-year-old, and just a couple of months ago we were sitting in the car, and again she's like third year DTS students, sort of know how to spell hermeneutics but have a little bit of an interpretive problem or challenge. So she's sitting in the car beside me, and she says, she's looking at this $5 note. And she says, Dad, it says, in God we trust here. isn't that amazing? And I'm like, yeah, I mean, it's amazing. You know, I try to sort of explain that, you know, this country's kind of founded, I think, on some sort of Christian basis and blah, blah. And so we leave it at that. I mumble something at her. And then about 2 seconds later, I hear her gasp, like, oh, and I look over and she's looking at the other side. And in a very respectful way, she says, Dad, I didn't know God was so ugly. And I don't know if you know your $5 notes, but Abraham Lincoln's face is on the back of that. And poor girl was sort of having a hermeneutical problem that she was putting two together, and she thought, wow, that's frightening. And then there's my seven-year-old, and he's like DTS, advanced DTS students, or profs. He's a little bit more developed in his thinking. And a few years ago this happened. I took him to school, I picked him up from school, and you go into this nursery waiting area, and it's designed for very little people. And you sit there waiting, and it's really awkward because you're, you know, sitting in little benches, and there's little fluffy clouds and smiling hippos on the walls. And then as we waited, I saw that right in the front, there was a poster that said, "From the wisdom from the mouths of babes." And really what it was is a collection of sayings that the teacher had gathered from the students in the class, my son being one, and put them on this poster. And so you had a little quote from James that said something like, "I love doggies because they go woof." And Annie, who said, "I love to brush my hair with a hairbrush." You know, things five-year-olds say. And I, of course, was looking for my son, Joshua's statement, and it was right bang in the middle. And it said this, "God knows everything, and so do I." So, as you can see, I'm having a few theological challenges at home, and they are funny. I mean, they are funny in kids. They're not so funny when our theology gets so warped and disconnected from the fruit that it's meant to bear in us. Those of us who spend hours reading books on God and hours sitting in classes listening to instruction from the scriptures on our God and attending chapel services and listening to sermon after sermon after sermon. I think it's Paul who says that knowledge can puff up. And that's the danger that we can have in a wonderful theological hub like Dallas Seminary, which is why I love that at some point the leadership of this place made it very, very clear that what we stand for is that you teach truth and that you love well. They go together. They're inseparable. They're like chips and salsa. I was at a Mexican restaurant the other day, and the guy brings me a bowl of salsa, and he doesn't give me a spoon and says, "Tuck in." He brings me chips. And he says, "You dip it in and you eat it, and it tastes wonderful." They go together. Chips and salsa. Teach truth. Love well. Where I come from, it's like fish and chips or a cup of tea and a bicky. Right? Or like your peas and carrots. They go together. I don't know if Dr. Bach is here, but it's like Dr. Pepper and Dr. Bach. I don't know if you know him well. There's always a can of Dr. Pepper alongside of him. Teach truth. Love well. Again, I believe it's Paul that says in 1 Corinthians 13 that you could be extremely gifted in many, many ways, but if there's no love tacked on it, you're just noise. Annoying noise. I don't want to pick on anyone, so I'll pick on one professor to show you the difficulty that it can be to live in that motto of teaching truth and loving well on a daily basis. And so I'll pick on me. I was at Starbucks not too long ago, and I was sitting there, Bible open, loving my time with the Lord. I found a corner where nobody could mess with me. And I journal, and I'm journaling, and I'm preparing class material, preparing to teach truth here. And I realize that the table beside me is literally nearly on top of me. And now there's a lady sitting there. I can kind of feel her breath on the back of my neck, and it's getting really, really awkward. And so I'm kind of looking like that at her, and she says, "Oh, you've beautiful writing." And I'm like, "Well, thank you. I work on it, but you know, this is my journal. This is my wife doesn't read this. You know, I'm thinking back off a little bit." And then she proceeds to talk to me in what seemed to me like an Irish accent. And I'm thinking, oh, here we have another one who wants to practice her Irish accent on me. And so I'm kind of into myself, yet smiling to her. I'm sort of trying to politely say, you know, it's me and God time here. I've stuff to do. And she keeps talking and talking and talking. And I give her my best Jesus smile for about 10 minutes. And then it starts to get a little bit more serious. But she keeps talking and talking and talking. And it turns out that this lady is living in her car. And she has two teenage kids. And she's no money. And she's just been stood up for a job interview at Starbucks. The guy didn't show up. And she is from Northern Ireland. And I'm trying to get her to back off because I'm having time with God. And God's trying to tell me, no, mate, your time with me is with her. I providentially positioned you together so that you could love this lady. I feel in this all the time. In fact, at the risk of bursting out into tears, I made my daughter cry the other day while I was teaching her maths because she wasn't getting it and it was frustrating me. How dare I? So how do you love well? That's what I want to talk to us about today. How do you love well? It's that well bit that gets me. How do you love well? That's where your understanding of God's truth and your understanding of God himself bears fruit. That's where we really know whether what you're teaching it is in you, whether you've got it. So how do you love well? So turn, please, to Acts. Turn to Acts chapter 4. Acts is a wonderful book. I'm sure you've read it. You've certainly got plenty of observations out of the beginning of it at some point in your training here. But without giving you a preview of the entire book, the book of Acts is really the Acts of the Holy Spirit. It's not the Acts of the Apostles, it's the Acts of the Holy Spirit through the Apostles and through the community of believers as they spread the gospel of God's salvation to the ends of the earth despite ongoing opposition. And in chapter 4, I want you to meet one of my personal heroes. He's not a superstar in the New Testament. He's not a Paul and a Peter and a John. He's a commoner, which draws me to him. He's like most of us are and will ever be. This is not like Billy Graham here. It's just a commoner. But he has so much to show us with regards to how you can love well as you teach truth. So turn to chapter 4, verses 36 and 37. Let me read them to you. Joseph, a Levite from Cyprus, whom the apostles called Barnabas, which means son of encouragement. So his name is Barnabas, parenthesis, I don't want you to miss this, which means son of encouragement. Verse 37, he sold a field that he owned, and he brought the money, and he put it at the apostles' feet. So it's Barnabas, personal hero of mine. I'm sort of gathering my thoughts to write on him. My doctoral work was on this chap, and I think God is using him in the book of Acts to cast our way a role model for us to imitate so that we can see what loving well looks like. If you want a list of how to love well, go to 1 Corinthians 13. Patience, kindness, not arrogance, not rudeness. But if you want to see it in the activities of an individual, you go to people like Barnabas. So let me explain to you a couple of things that are going on here in the text. In the verses that just precede that, what Luke has provided for us structurally is a little snapshot, a little window, a little peek into life in the early church. And it's beautiful. These guys, despite all the opposition that they're enduring, are gathered together as a community and they love one another. And off of that, Luke wants you to see two examples. One we just read is Barnabas. That's the positive example. The negative example is what follows, chapter 5, verses 1 to 11. You know the story, Ananias and Sapphira. And to make you connect the dots, literally, as you read through that, you'll see that both are members of the same community. Both are Christians. And Luke wants you to see that both own land. Both are landowners. And both sell the land. And both bring the proceeds of that sale to the church. Both give. But one gives in a God-endorsed manner, and the other gives in a way that brings God's discipline upon their lives. Luke wants you to see that. Put them together. Land is a big deal in this. You know, when we think of status in our society, we think of education, and we think of what profession do you have or how much money do you have. Those are issues that in our social network and hierarchies help you move up. In that society, it really doesn't work like that. You can have a lot of money and not be of high status. What works is land. Do you have land? And anybody with, you know, European background like I do gets that a little bit more, where land is something you inherit and you do not pass on, right, through sale. You pass it on to your kids. And so when we read about Barnabas selling this field that he owns, he's giving up more than just money. He's giving up position and status at the street level. He's willing to say, you know what, there's people in this community whom I really, really love. I've heard their prayer requests. I've watched their kids maybe cause a ruckus in Sunday school because they're hungry. And so he opens his eyes and he opens his ears and he opens his heart and he sticks his hand in his pocket and he opens his wallet. And he's even willing to surrender it, right, to the distribution of by the leadership of the church, which is, for me, remarkable. How do you love well? Barnabas tells us in this, among other things, that you love well with your wallet. It's as practical and it's as simple as that. Who here has a wallet? Come on, be honest. Who here has an object that contains money? Okay, you're trying to wiggle out of that, right? Yeah, you have a wallet. It's as simple as that. Generosity with your stuff. Generosity with the books that you have, generosity with the car that you drive, generosity with the home that you have can make a difference in the life of people and can be an expression of what you say you believe. And I believe that when you tap into generosity, you tap into pleasure sensors that are hardwired into your life, being made in the image of God, that fill you with joy. God is a generous God. Barnabas gets that. Our family has a very dear friend whom we call Uncle Stanley. Uncle Stanley is a very wealthy man in his 80s now, who for about six decades has supported missionaries on the mission field all over the world, my parents included, in the Canary Islands. And I was sitting having lunch with Uncle Stanley last summer, and he was sharing a little bit with me about his story once again. And one of the things he says is, Jonathan, I fought with God because I pleaded with him to send me to the mission field. And God said, no. You need to stay at home and send others to the mission field. And so he did. He started a business, and it was very prosperous. And for six decades, he has funded missionaries all over the world. And he leaned over and he said this. He said, Jonathan, the sad reality is this, that the last part of a man to get saved is his wallet. I thought, wow. The last part of a man to get saved is his wallet. Barnabas loves with his wallet. Hop over to chapter 9. I want to show you a few more things with this individual. He doesn't feature until chapter 9, Barnabas, and he features in chapter 9 for one verse. Now, if you know anything about Acts, and if you've heard about the Apostle Paul, and I hope you have, this is the first account of the conversion of the Apostle Paul on his road to on his way to Damascus, right? This is a huge chapter in this book, and tucked in there, in one verse, our friend Barnabas features. And if you're reading your Bible through in a year, you're going to read right past it. Right, you've no time to camp out on him. But let me do that. Go to verse 26 and let me read it for you. When he came to Jerusalem, that's Paul, when he came to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, but they were all afraid of him, not believing that he really was a disciple. And I get that, right? This is a guy that was going that way to kill all these people, and now he's here. This could be a trick. This could be a trap. There's no way we're going to go and meet this guy, Paul or Saul. Verse 27, but Barnabas took him, brought him to the apostles. He told them how Saul on his journey had seen the Lord and that the Lord had spoken to him and how in Damascus he had preached fearlessly in the name of Jesus. So Paul stayed with them, moved about freely in Jerusalem, speaking boldly in the name of the Lord. He talked and debated with the Grecian Jews, but they tried to kill him. When the brothers learned of this, they took him down to Caesarea and sent him off to Tarsus. Paul tries to join the church in Jerusalem. They're having none of it. Barnabas intercedes for him. So they accept Paul. Paul ministers freely in the city and is so successful that his opponents try to kill him. There's a murder plot on his life and he has to evacuate and he heads home to Tarsus. You'd miss that Barnabas is the bridge through which Paul's initial ministry begins to get launched. He speaks up for Paul when nobody will give this guy an audience because he sees past people's past. He sees past their failed track record and he sees potential, which is exactly how God sees any human being, full of potential. So he speaks up. How do you love well? Barnabas tells that you love well with your words. Not just with your wallet, but with your words. Who here has a mouth? Is there a tongue in that mouth? Wiggle it. Yeah, you've got a wallet and you've got a mouth. Now, again, it's no exaggeration to say that the Apostle Paul is probably second most influential individual in Christianity, right? First being Christ himself. This guy goes on to write a third of the New Testament. That's remarkable. Now, again, go over to chapter 15, but on your way, don't stop, I don't have time, but on your way, at some point, read chapter 11, because there's a thriving church that's developing in Antioch, and the church in Jerusalem says, we need to send our best up there, and who do they pick? They pick Barnabas. And he heads up there, and when Barnabas is there, he says, who do I need? I need Paul. And he goes over to Tarsus, and he brings Paul and launches him, gives him a platform in Antioch. And then he takes him under his wing in chapters 13 and 14 and says, let's go on a missionary journey. We call it Paul's first missionary journey. I don't want to mess up your sort of Bible classes, but personally, and I'm biased, I think it's Barnabas' first missionary journey that Paul gets to go on. That's what's going on here. But anyway, that's on the side. Get to chapter 15, verse 36 and down. It's the last little section right at the end of this Jerusalem Council event in Acts, which is a hugely important event. But right there in 36, it says that the Paul and Barnabas decide to have another missionary journey. And so verse 37, I'll pick up there. It says, Barnabas wanted to take John, also called Mark, with them. But Paul did not think it wise to take him because he had deserted them in Pamphylia and had not continued with them in the work. And he hadn't. He had abandoned them in chapter 13. They had such a sharp disagreement that they parted company. Barnabas took Mark and sailed for Cyprus, but Paul chose Silas and left, commended by their brothers to the grace of the Lord. He went through Syria and Cilicia, strengthening the churches. So without getting a map out, Barnabas heads home, Cyprus, with John Mark, and Paul heads home, that's the direction of Tarsus, with Silas. And people make too much of this sharp disagreement. It's a disagreement on what to do with Mark. It's not like we're not friends anymore and so we're going to huff, in my opinion. But what's remarkable to me is what Barnabas does for John Mark. He speaks up for him. He sees past his past. He risks on a risky individual, despite his failed track record. He has failed. Because Barnabas can see potential in this chap. If somebody would just speak life, right? If somebody would just put an arm around him and encourage him. Now, Barnabas essentially sails off to Cyprus and off the pages of history. You don't hear about him ever again. But you've read the Gospel of Mark. And most, not all, I'll not look that way, most, not all, would say that the Gospel of Mark influenced the Gospel of Matthew. And the Gospel of Mark influenced the Gospel of Luke, who wrote also Acts. And so there's another huge chunk of the New Testament that is the product of a protege of Barnabas. And all he did was he loved them well with his words. That's what he did. So it's remarkable, really. I jot this down so that when you head home, you can do it. I'm going to give you a little bit of homework. Go home and read Acts 4 again, 36 and 37. And here's what you're going to see there, that Barnabas is a nickname. The guy's called Joseph. That's his birth name. But the early church are so impressed with the way this guy is around their community that they nickname him. Stuff the birth name. Let's stick with the nickname. And the nickname is Son of Encouragement or Son of Comfort. Son of Paraclesis. Now, one of the major words that the early church used to refer to the Holy Spirit, and this is the Acts of the Holy Spirit, is the Paraclete. This guy is the presence of the Holy Spirit among us. He's an encourager when things are tough. He's a comfort to us. He's God among us. And if you go and continue your homework at home later on tonight, to chapter 9 in Acts. Remember I told you that Paul tries to join the church in Jerusalem. They're having none of it. Barnabas intercedes. Paul gets to join. Ministers freely, very successfully, murder plot in his life, and he has to evacuate. If you read the text well, if you privilege the text, as Dr. Carrivoli here, if you privilege the text, you will see that that has already happened in chapter 9 of Acts. Paul's on his way to Damascus. The Lord meets him on that way and grabs a hold of his life. So Paul's going to try and meet the church in Damascus. And the church in Damascus, through a man called Ananias, says, there's no way. But we know, as the story unfolds, that Paul gets to join the church in Damascus because he does so, it says that, and he ministers freely in Damascus. So much so that his ministry is such a success that there is a murder plot on his life. And he has to evacuate Damascus, which is why we picked him up in Jerusalem. And again, if you read well and you study well, you'll see that Luke is putting these two scenes together. And he's saying, guys, connect the dots. You know that little matching the object game that you play with kids? I've got four kids at home. We do this. That's what he's doing. Match things. And when you match things, you will see that Barnabas, in the second part of Acts 9, is functioning as who? As God in the first of those two scenes. Barnabas is just doing for Paul in Jerusalem what God did for Paul in Damascus. This guy is in step with God. And he launches these wonderful people. That's how I think he's cast for us in the book of Acts. Again, you'd read right past it if you didn't slow down to read about the life of this just common, regular servant of the Lord. My dad has had a huge influence on my life. I mean, I'd love to tell you, it's just so many things that apply to this that he has embodied. But one of his best buddies is a guy called Brian. Now, Brian and Dad grew up from like no age together. They both come from a really, really rough part of Belfast. And Dad's dad, my granddad, essentially died as a result of the Second World War. He was shot or something like that. He was a soldier. And so Dad was pretty much brought up with his mom and his sisters and always out playing on the streets with Brian. And over about 5 decades, Dad and Brian have ministered on and off together. Beautiful story. So Dad would call Brian his Barnabas. And every Sunday, without missing a beat, every Sunday, Brian will either text or phone my dad before Dad heads up. My dad's a pastor, before he gets up to preach, just to encourage him, to speak encouragement into his life, to lift him up before he goes out and proclaims the oracles of God. And Dad was telling me not too long ago about a story about Brian and he. They went into a shop, and Brian needed to buy 2 loaves of bread. So he got to the shelf, and there were 2 loaves of bread. Brilliant. Brian got 1 loaf of bread and took it to the cashier. And Dad says, Brian, you needed 2. There's 2. And Brian says, maybe somebody else later on will come in needing a loaf of bread. And I thought, wow. There's a guy who's so in touch with the needs of people around him that he is anticipating the need of someone coming in later on to get a loaf of bread. I need it, I want it, but what about the next guy? That's loving well with your wallet. That's loving well with your words. That's a kind of love that communicates that you've got God's truth, that you've exited time with him. Not with him as a topic in a class or in your reading material. I'm reading this book at the minute. I'm pretty much done. It's called A Hobbit, A Wardrobe, and A Great War. It's a fantastic read. And essentially, it's about the impact of the First World War, the Great War, on Tolkien, who wrote The Lord of the Rings, and C.S. Lewis. Both of these individuals fought in the First World War. And they came out of that tragedy and projected into their stories the realities of life in that sort of real world. But of course, they both turned to Christ and saw in life the hope of the resurrection and life with God. And so it's remarkable what I'm reading. I mean, it's a brutal war. 6,049 men a day died in that war for 4 years. That was a slaughterhouse. And so as you read this and you read about this guy's interpretation from Tolkien's work about how that war shaped his stories, it's remarkable. One of the things that emerges out of it is hobbits. I told you, Dr. Bailey told you, I've got 4 little hobbits at home. And what's remarkable is that hobbits, if you know Lord of the Rings, are weak little creatures, intentionally made small to communicate that they're not the powerful guys in this imaginary world. They're not the ones who can fight a battle. They're not the kings. They're not the warriors. They're just commoners who are determined and who are courageous and who care for one another. Well, the main character in Lord of the Rings is Frodo, right? He's the guy who has to take the ring and get it to the mountains so that it's eliminated. And yet he's the main character, but he's not the hero of the story, according to Tolkien. The hero in the story is a guy called Sam Gamgee, Frodo's little sidekick, who just encourages him all the way through. Let me read you a little piece, I think of time. Likewise for Tolkien, who emerged from the war with a profound respect for the ordinary soldier. As an officer in the British Army, he could not befriend many of the privates who made up his battalion, nor the batmen, the servants who were assigned to look after the officer's gears and attend to his daily needs. But war has a way of softening military hierarchies. As Tolkien fought alongside these soldiers, he witnessed again and again their remarkable determination under fire. Their care, their courage, their concern, their camaraderie. Indeed, as he later acknowledged, one of the heroic figures in The Lord of the Rings, a hobbit, is based on his first-hand knowledge of the men of the in the trenches of the Great War. And here's what he says, quote, "My Sam Gamgee is indeed a reflection of the English soldier, of the simple privates and batmen I knew in the 1914 war, and recognized them as being far superior to myself." And later on he writes, "Sam Gamgee is this jewel among the hobbits." Beautiful. Barnabas is Sam Gamgee to Paul and to Mark and to the early church. And he shows us how we are to love well. And he's this fully cooked theologian. What I mean by that is that he's allowed God's truth to so bake him that he squirts out love. God knows everything. My 7-year-old son is correct. God knows everything. We don't. Neither does my 7-year-old. But we know him. And if we really know him, we love well. And if we love well, the truth that we teach is heard and is attractive. Amen?
Amen. Amen.